Good morning, everyone. We are ready to resume the international conference on the question of Jerusalem with the second plenary session entitled Historical and Contemporary Models of Coexistence. As we did yesterday, once all the presentations have been made, the floor will be open for questions and comments from the audience, to which our speakers will respond. Before starting, I would like to kindly request our speakers to stay within the 15 minutes time limit so that there will be some time for a discussion. I would now like to welcome as our first speaker Mr. Menachem Klein, professor and author of several books, including Lives in Common, Arabs and Jews in Jerusalem, Jaffa and Hebron. Professor Klein was also active in many unofficial negotiations with Palestinian counterparts. He is a board member of the Palestine-Israel Journal and has been on the board of the non-governmental organization B'Tselem, which documents human rights violations in the occupied territories and helps to create a human rights culture in Israel. We are honored to have you with us, sir. You have the floor.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. Thank you, everyone who woke up so early in the morning after an exhausting day yesterday and the reception and dinner. I would like to share with you a few of my observations, conclusions in the book, my latest book, Lives in Common, regarding the Jerusalem in the pre-48 war. The book covers 150 years of Jewish-Arab relations, and here I would like to relate to one portion, one chapter in my book, which is very interesting because many of us suffer from a kind of amnesia. We tend to forget our past, although we are shaped by our past, and we rewrite it constantly. So it's worth looking back to the past and the past relations between Jews and Arabs in Jerusalem from the late 19th century up to 48 war. 48 war is a watershed that divides the relations between Jews and Arabs in the city, in particular, in Palestine in general, and therefore it is justified to divide relations between before and after the 48 war. I would like to speak about only a few examples that will give you a hint, give you a concept or some understanding of the relations that were there on the ground between Jews and Arabs. I will relate to the languages that people spoke, where they lived, the neighborhoods, religious festivals and holy places, and then I will end up with a story, a very touching story on Jewish-Arab relations during the first stage of the 48 war. We have a wrong concept in our mind regarding the old city and the division into exclusive ethnic neighborhoods, Jewish quarter, Muslim quarter, Christian, Armenian. The concept of exclusive ethnic neighborhoods, quarters, is wrong. Totally wrong. Definitely in the late 19th century, perhaps earlier, but definitely up to 48 war, there were no exclusive quarters in the old city. The neighborhoods were highly mixed, and therefore people spoke many languages, Actually, I follow here Professor Salim Tamari, the sociologist, the historian sociologist from Beer Zeit University, who concluded that Jerusalem was, up to 48 war, a cosmopolitan city. And actually, I further base his conclusion. Jerusalem was a very cosmopolitan city before 48 war. So the neighborhoods were mixed. People spoke many languages. For instance, at the beginning of the of 1960, the Jerusalem Municipal Archives asked 38 Jews about their lives at the turn of the century. In this group, 14 knew five languages, with only two who used only two languages. The most common ones they cited, other than Hebrew, were Arabic, English, Yiddish, Ladino, German, and French. Some spoke Russian, Turkish, and Italian. Movement between Jerusalem and Europe went both ways. Jerusalem inhabitants not only met tourists on the streets of their city, but were at times themselves tourists in Europe. Most of the people interviewed by the municipality made overseas trips at that time, whether for their studies or for businesses, a vacation or family visit. So the movement, many people came to Jerusalem, and Jerusalemites went out to visit Europe. No mental boundary separated Muslims and Jewish areas. The barriers of language and culture posed few impediments, and whoever ventured into the physical sphere of the other felt quite at home there. And I use many Jewish memoirs and archive documents, but for instance, I will mention here Yaakov Yoshua, the father of the novelist A.B. Yoshua. Yaakov Yoshua's grandmother taught Ladino to the girls of Jauni family. Muslims from other neighborhoods sat in the cafe of David Elbaz and Ben Zion Dabash, both of them were Jews, in the street of the Jews, in the Jewish quarter. Young Jews were attracted by the Arab El Bashura and El Muna cafe in El Wad Street. El Wad Street is in the Muslim quarter in the old city of Jerusalem, since these were more refined than their Jewish counterparts. And I quote now few words from Eliyahu Eliashar, another Jew who lived in Jerusalem. "We heard Arabic and spoke perfectly fluently with our neighbors," he writes in his memoirs. End of quote. "Most of the landlords of the houses in which Jews lived in old Jerusalem were Muslims, and the relations between them transcended those of tenants and landlords." I quote, "Each Sephardic family was friendly with a Muslim family," end of quote. Muslims exhibit more than mere friendliness when reciting Jewish prayers. Muslims, I now quote, "eventually learned to speak Ladino, particularly with the women. And whoever developed ties with their Jewish neighbors also learned a few sentences of Hebrew, mainly from the prayers. And they would frequently show off their knowledge by reciting the appropriate blessing upon drinking a glass of water or partaking of some cake." This is a quotation from a Jewish memoir. "They were entirely familiar with the Jewish holidays and shared the neighborhood's joys," Yaakov Elazar wrote in his memoirs. Now, against the conventional wisdom that only Oriental Jews, the Sephardi Jews, spoke Arabic, I must say that also I found that also Ashkenazi Jews too were in daily contact with Arabs. The ongoing contacts between Ashkenazi Jews and Arabs led to the influx of Arabic words, expressions, and proverbs into Palestinian Yiddish. Arabic influenced the local Yiddish dialect to a greater extent than did Turkish or the Ladino spoken by the Sephardi Jews. Moreover, while sexual relations and marriage between Jews and Muslim or Christian Arabs were considered illegitimate, they were not unknown and accepted as a matter of fact, as a matter of everyday life. The religious community did not dictate to its members to live in exclusive quarter, as I said. People did not live in exclusive Jewish-Muslim quarter. For instance, Yoshua Yelin, Jewish family, settled in Bab el-Huta in the Muslim quarter in the mid-19th century. And in the 1860s and 70s, Jews lived in the Muslim quarter along the Wad Street as far as its northeastern end. At the end of the 19th century, Ashkenazi Jewish family members rented a house in the Muslim quarter close to Herod's Gate. And in 1908, Chaim Aharon Valero leased land to the Muslim school Rauzat el-Ma'aruf and contributed the rental payment to the school. The religious festivals were celebrated and holy places were celebrated by both Jews and Arabs, and the holy places were shared by both of them, local holy places. Religious holidays were not private family events conducted within the confines of the home. They were celebrated in the streets and in the neighborhood, and members of other religions participated in the festivities. For instance, in his memoirs, Wasif Jawariye, a Palestinian well-known person, musician, donned fancy dress to take part in the gay Purim celebrations with his Jewish neighbors. Alongside other Muslim and Christian families, the Jawariya family likewise took part in the pilgrimage to the tomb of Shimon HaTzadik, Simon the Righteous Man, in Sheikh Jarrah neighborhood, which today, just fast forward, today it is an exclusive Jewish holy site. The Jews turn it exclusive Jewish holy site, but originally it was inclusive holy shrine. So even religious festivals and holy places, local holy places, were shared by all the local people, Jews and Arabs, Christians, Muslims alike. Moreover, let's see what happens when there are conflicts between the two national movements. Following violent anti-British and anti-Zionist 1919 and 1920 demonstrations erupted during Nabi Musa pilgrimage, the Jews had mixed feelings. Jews, and I quote, recall the initial days, meaning before 1919, writes Ezra Menachem, another Jew, when, now I quote, young and old alike took up positions already in the morning next to the gate of the wall, the old city wall, to welcome the Nabi Musa celebrants with fanfare. Their flag bedecked possessions passed along the lanes of the Jews to the sound of drums and cymbals. The Jews cheered them and sprinkled rose water on them. Yet the Jews were apprehensive after the 1919-20 riots. Their stores were half closed. And then Ezra Menachem continues, a few days had passed since the riots, and regular life resumed. Jews and Arabs met one another once more, and both parties apologized for what had occurred and for the blood that had been spilled. End of quote. The Jerusalem before 48, city center, for instance, the Musrara neighborhood, or the city center where Zion Square and Ben Yehuda Street were all shared by Jews and Arabs. They sat in the same coffee shops. The legal elite, Katan family, Katan lawyers firm had its office in Sansur building together with the Jewish legal elite, the best Jewish lawyers at that time that later on became high court judges. The whole area was mixed. Now I would like to concentrate on one area in South Jerusalem, the area of Katamon, Talbiye, and Baqa. South Jerusalem neighborhoods were populated by members of the middle and upper classes, college-educated professionals, senior officials, well-known businessmen, contractors, traders, doctors, architects, and lawyers like Khalil Sakakini, Mikhail Sansour, Sami Hawaidi, the poet Fadwa Tukan, and the musician Tawfiq Jawariya. Their children attended multilingual private schools. The parents were members, for instance, the YMCA. They also participated in parties or sat in the lobby of King David Hotel together with the British. The King David Hotel was the center of the Jerusalem elites. And the Talbiye had two mukhtars, head of the community. The Jewish mukhtar of Talbiye was a person called Reuven Mas, while the Arab Mukhtar was Ibrahim Kabani. Each of the two Mukhtars issued residential permits and birth certificates to the members of the community. And I speak now in the 30s and the 40s. Mas, Reuven Mas, moved to Talbiye in 1933, and he and his family were the only Jews in the neighborhood for 2 years. The war, 48 war, turned these neighborhoods into, for all intents and purposes, wholly Jewish ones, and later on, they were gentrified. Now, in April 48, Reuven Mas, the Jewish Mukhtar, carefully recorded who entered which house, apartment, or room vacant by the Arabs. The Arabs left, Palestinian Arabs left this area in April, and Reuven Mas very carefully recorded who left and who entered in which room, which apartment. He also preserved all the letters and messages he received from Israeli officials. One of them I saw in the archive is from Shimon Peres regarding the assignment of housing to Jews. Mas issued newcomers housing receipt certificates on which he recorded precisely which unit each one received. The new residents were required to care for the furniture in the home and keep watch over the closed rooms where the belongings of the Palestinians left behind them were collected. The Jewish residents also obligated themselves on the certificate to vacant the property within 1 month if the legal owner so demand. Mas also listed whether the person receiving the property was married and had children, his profession, and the number of people who moved into the property. In doing so, he was not only acting at the behest of the Situation Committee in Jerusalem, a body charged with putting the new state's governing apparatus in place, but also out of the sense of personal responsibility towards his Arab neighborhoods. Now I quote from his memoirs. In keeping with the good relations that we had with the Arab population here, I demanded that we preserve Arab property. In every home, we set aside a room and put all the belongings to the owner inside, with the exception of tables and chairs with beds, which we had to make available to the refugees, the Jewish refugees that entered, refugees from other parts of Jerusalem, that the war refugees, Jewish war refugees that had to leave their homes. He wrote it in 1974. I continue. For additional immigrants and refugees, and government officials were sent to transfer all belongings to warehouses. What happened to them in the end, I have no idea. End of quote. Of course, it disappeared, people took it, and so on. But here is the very touching point. It's worth knowing that Mas issued this document when he was a bereaved person, father. His son Danny, a Haganah militia officer, was killed by Palestinian mob in January, less than 3 months earlier. Despite this, he hoped that soon his Palestinian neighborhoods return and wanted to assure that they will be able to return to their original homes. And this is the type of relations that was there in Jerusalem prior to 48 war and the first stage of the 48 war. So we need to acknowledge that this is our past, the shared past of Jews and Arabs, and this legacy is necessary for us to know the present and enable us to have a different future.
I thank Mr. Klein for his presentation and for his fascinating account detailing examples of coexistence between Arabs and Jews in Jerusalem in earlier years. Our next speaker is Mr. Azumardi Azra, Senior Professor of Islamic History and Culture and 8th Rector of Syarif Hidayatullah State Islamic University here in Jakarta. Mr. Azra is an outstanding historian, a progressive educator, and an Islamic intellectual who has earned high esteem for his advocacy of a centrist, moderate understanding of Islam. We're honored to have you with us, sir. You have the floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Very good morning. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Peace be upon all of you. Selamat pagi bagi kawan-kawan, para diplomat, Pak Dubes, Desra Percaya. Thank you very much for the invitation. I prepare a PowerPoint for this. Basically, what I am going to propose is that we need to increase or to empower interfaith dialogue for priests. This is, of course, based on Indonesian sharing experience with the believers in Jerusalem. I think we need to recall that Jerusalem is a land of Abrahamic faith. We have Judaism, the oldest, Christianity, and Islam. All of them, the three, are called in the Quran as the Millah Ibrahim, Abrahamic religion. Abrahamic religion. So basically, we are siblings. Yeah. I visited Jerusalem a number of times and also Tel Aviv, and then I visited the Aqsa Mosque, And then my host took me to the place where the Prophet Muhammad was believed to have his Mi'raj, yeah? Ascension to heaven, yeah? Where he met with a number of prophets, including of course Moses and Abraham. I visited also a great old church in Jerusalem, where parts of the church shared by different churches, different denominations of Christianity. In fact, the keys of the church were in the hands of Muslim mayor of Jerusalem, because otherwise these different denominations of churches of Christianity would fight each other. So they have to give the key to the so-called neutral hands. I visited also synagogue in one Sabbath evening, and then observing our Jewish brothers perform their rituals. So I think Islamic iman is quite distinctive, because all Muslims have to believe in the revelation of Torah and also Injil, the Old and New Testament. We have, of course, six pillars of belief. One of them is belief in past revelation, not only in the Quran. So if Muslims do not believe in the Torah and also in the Injil or New Testament, the belief, the iman, is not completed. But I also we know that Judaism and Islam is not do not have a single monolithic interpretation. There is a lot of different, sometimes conflicting school of religious thought, school of law of the two, from moderate to radical and fundamentalist. I was actually I visited also, as I don't know, you could call it probably enclave of the so-called ultra-Orthodox Jews in one part of Jerusalem. Of course, I think they are very distinctive in their attitude, their behavior. So this is one of the you could call it probably school of thought, school of because in this particular enclave of Jews, all the men, all they have to do all day is only to study Torah and Talmud. Yeah, I think. So I think that's why there should be strengthening and mainstreaming of the moderates in the two group of the believers. I believe that most of the Palestinian, also the Israelis, are reasonable people who have peace in mind. So I think we need to strengthen and to mainstream these mainstream moderates. So that's why the moderates of the two, of the Palestinian and also the Israeli, should play a greater role in the creation of peace among the Palestinian and Israelis. And of course, previous speakers talk about shared history, shared peace between the two nations, two group of people. Of course, we have a lot of shared history of peaceful coexistence in the Prophet Muhammad Medina city state. Remember the Al-Mithaq Al-Madinah, the constitution of Medina that guaranteed protection to life, protection to life, and also freedom of conscience, protection to property. So that's why one of the just recently passed away American sociologist of religion, Robert N. Bella, said that the constitution of Medina is too modern for recognizing the basic principle of human rights long before declaration of human rights adopted by the UN. So the Jews were part and parcel of Muslim polities in the Arab world. In North Africa, in Spain, they were expelled from Spain, of course, together. And the Ottoman, of course, the Ottoman system has been criticized by some because actually the Ottoman implemented what was called as millet system. So millet system is the special enclave for a special group of believers, including the Jews and also the Christians. There was a kind of Jewish cultural renaissance in the Middle Age during the role of Muslim polities. I should not elaborate this too much. So I think, again, we need to intensify dialogues in Jerusalem and beyond. There should be intensification of intra-Muslim first. Intra-Muslim between, you know, different groups of Muslims, Palestinian, not only Palestinian, Hamas and Fatah, but also among Muslims beyond the borders of Palestine and also Israel, including Saudi Arabia, Syria, Lebanon, and etc. And there should also be more interfaith dialogues among Muslim and Jewish, and also there should be intensification of intra-Muslim and intra-Jewish dialogues because you have different groups of Jews. There are Jewish groups who oppose Zionism, for instance, but there are some other, I think, Jews that could be called secular, probably, I don't know, but who do not have a very strong religious spirit, at least. And then at the same time, there should also be more interfaith dialogues among Muslim and Jewish religious leaders, particularly religious leaders, at different level of leadership, from top to middle and lower level of religious leadership, in order to develop mutual respect, in order to develop mutual understanding based on mutual interest to create peace in the area. And there should be also dialogues among intellectuals and NGO or peace activists in the two camps, in the two communities, in order to put pressures on political leaders to be more committed to peace rather than to violence. Now, let me talk a little bit about the Indonesia and Jews. Jewish traders reported to have reached Barus. Barus is a village in the northwest Sumatra in search for spices and other items for trade. And the number of Jews increased with the coming of the Portuguese and also the Dutch from the 16th century onwards. And in 1850, a synagogue was established in Surabaya, East Java. There were some 20 Jewish families in Batavia and Surabaya. Surabaya is the capital city now of East Java. But now the synagogue has been closed down because there is no Jews live in Surabaya. In 1930, the Dutch reported that there were more than 1,000 Jews in Netherlands East Indies, Netherlands Oost Indies, NOI. And then their number became some 2,500 at the end of 1930s. In 1920s, they established the Association for Jewish Interests in Netherlands Oost Indies. And in fact, there was a publication called Eretz Israel in Padang, in my home province, in my hometown. Quite long, from 1926 to the end to the beginning of World War II, 1942, the occupation of the Dutch. Now there is a synagogue in Manado, in Manado, North Sulawesi. I think almost 3 hours away from Jakarta by Garuda Indonesia airplane. Now in the Indonesia, Palestine and Israel, Indonesia fully support the Palestinian struggle as stated by our Minister of Foreign Affairs yesterday to gain independence and sovereignty. Indonesia has no diplomatic relation with Israel, nor has it an embassy in Ramallah so far. Even though the current president and vice president promised that we are going to open an Indonesian representative office in Ramallah. But I think, what is the latest development? Because I think last night I saw a running text on Indonesian TV that Indonesia is going to open an office, a consulate. It's called consulate in Ramallah. I don't know. And President Suharto, of course, the strong man of Indonesia, in 1993 met with the Israel Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin in his Cendana residence, not far from here. In 1999, President Abdurrahman Wahid proposed the opening of trade relations between Indonesia and Israel. And of course, certain Muslim group, particularly hardliners, opposed this move. Yeah. And so President Abdurrahman Wahid, President Wahid, had to cancel his proposal. And President Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono in 2005, actually in the UN headquarters in New York, said that formal ties between the two countries, between Indonesia and Israel, possible only after peace is reached between Israel and Palestine. And the last one, of course, I already mentioned, President Jokowi and Vice President Indonesia now is going to open. Now, what about Indonesia and dialogues with Palestinian and Israelis? Palestinian ulama leaders and intellectuals have been invited to join interfaith dialogues and alliance of civilization conferences in Indonesia held by NU. NU is the largest Muslim organization in Indonesia with membership something like 50 million people across the country, established in 1926. And Muhammadiyah is the second largest Muslim organization in Indonesia, even established even older in 1912, with membership something like 40 million people. I think we are very fortunate in Indonesia to have this Islamic-based civil society organization. They are very active, of course, but they are non-political. They are critical partners of government, criticizing president or other high official from time to time. And of course, one of the leaders was Abdurrahman Wahid, that was elected as our president during the transition to democracy in 1999 to 2001. And Jewish rabbis and intellectuals coming from US, Australia, and Europe also joined dialogues and conferences in Indonesia. You can see I met them from time to time. Indonesian government and institutions have invited conflicting Palestinian groups, Fatah and Hamas, to have dialogues in Indonesia, of course, yeah, from time to time also. And when I gave a lecture at the special training course of Indonesian Foreign Ministry, I met also, I think, at one point, nine Palestinian diplomats join the conversation on interfaith dialogue. And then I think 2 years ago we had also similar meeting here at this Borobudur Hotel. Some NGO activists and intellectuals have been invited to Israel by NGOs, government institutions, and universities, attending peace camp during summer time, I think, if I'm not mistaken. I sent a number of my younger colleagues from State Islamic University to join this youth camp in Israel, in Tel Aviv, I think, somewhere or outside of Tel Aviv, and also conferences and giving lectures. I was also have been invited. I was invited to give a lecture in a number of Israeli universities, including Hebrew and Bar Ilan University in Tel Aviv. Now, what can Indonesia share for peace in not only in Jerusalem but in between among Palestinians and Israelis? Indonesia is a showcase of pluralism and multiculturalism. Achieved independence on August 17, 1945, consists of more than 17,000 islands, hundreds of ethnic groups who speak different languages and have distinctive socio-cultural tradition. Indonesia, of course, has a strong tradition of pluralism and multiculturalism and a meeting points of various religions and beliefs that, by and large, have lived in peace and harmony for centuries. We have six recognized religions in Indonesia. Ms. Wendy just asked me about, Indonesia as a majority Muslim country. I think we have not only Islam, of course, the largest religion in Indonesia with adherence something like more than 88% of total population. And then we have Protestantism, the second distant minority, second largest, something like 6 to 7%. Catholicism, Hinduism, Buddhism, and Confucianism. In Indonesia, Confucianism is regarded as a religion, even though in China it is only philosophy. And administration of believers is conducted by the Ministry of Religious Affairs that doesn't interfere in theological and ritual matters of religion. And different these religious groups generally live in peace and harmony in Indonesia. And despite the fact that Indonesia, majority of the population is Muslim, but Indonesia is not based on Islam. This is very important. Nor is Islam is the official religion of the state. Indonesia is based on Pancasila. Pancasila simply means five pillars. Belief in one supreme God, just and civilized humanity, Indonesian unity, people democracy based on wisdom and representation and social justice for the Indonesian people. With Pancasila as the basis, Indonesian state is not a confessional state. It's not based on any confession. Nor is it a purely secular state. Even though some people said that Indonesia is a secular state because Indonesia is not based on religion. But if you look at the first pillar of Pancasila, and then Pancasila is, I call as a religiously friendly basis of the Indonesian state, or religiously friendly ideology of Indonesian state. Religion is a part and parcel of public life because in Indonesia we celebrate all the major religious holidays, five for Islam, four for Christianity, I think one for Hindus, one for Buddhists, and one for Confucianists. It is official holiday, and president and vice president join the celebration. We are off from office during these holidays. So Pancasila is the common platform. In Islamic term, it is called as Kalimatun Sawa, common platform, common word, and crucial integrating force of plural and multicultural Indonesia that is recognized in one of the four principles of the Indonesian state, that is Bhinneka Tunggal Ika. E pluribus umum, the American said. This is Bhinneka Tunggal Ika, diversity within unity. Indonesian Islam is Wasatiyah Islam, Middle Fast Islam, Moderate Islam, Inclusive Islam. Strong tradition of inclusiveness, tolerance, and peaceful coexistence with adherence of other religions. Indonesian Islam is the least Arabicized Muslim country, but no less Islamic. Yeah, there have been a number of research on whether Indonesian Muslim are more loyal to, let's say, to pray five times a day or probably some other Muslim. You can find this kind of research. In Indonesia, Indonesian Islam provides much greater freedom to Muslim women in religious, social, cultural, and political lives. I am very happy to tell you that Indonesia is the only country that allow women to be a chief judge in the Islamic court. Women treated equally as a male. Indonesian Islam is civil Islam. I already mentioned the name NU and Muhammadiyah, the largest. They represent civil Islam, religious-based civil society, independent from the state, self-regulating, self-financing, mediating between state and people at the grassroots level, nurture civic culture and civility that are crucial for democracy to be vibrant. They also accept modernity and modernization, but no to secularism, no problem with modern issues like family planning. So that's why Indonesia is the most successful country, majority Muslim country in family planning. President Suharto was awarded by the UN for this success of family planning. Freedom, human rights, gender equality and equity and others. I should not talk interfaith. So Indonesia has a strong and long tradition of intra and interfaith dialogue. Intrafaith means dialogue among different denomination of school of thought within one particular religion. Interfaith dialogue means dialogues among different religions. And then interfaith dialogues include issues related to theology, doctrines, rituals, social culture, and humanity. Okay. And then you can have dialogue from top to the lowest level of leadership. Aims of interfaith dialogue to create and enhance mutual understanding and respect intra and inter religious group. To find common ground, to formulate early warning system. Early warning system means that if something would happen, and then you can be in contact. And also to create networks of religious leaders. This is very important, networks of different religious leaders. I should stop. There are three kinds of interfaith dialogues, intrafaith dialogue, interfaith dialogue, and also dialogues between Council of Religions and government. This is also important because the government, of course, is very important, I think. There are many institutions that play a role in this intra and interfaith dialogues, I think. I believe among Israelis and Palestinians, there are these groups, and then you could empower them to be involved in more dialogue, and of course Indonesian Foreign Ministry has been very active in interfaith dialogues in cooperation with Ministry of Religious Affairs. We conducted a number of interfaith dialogues in Europe, in North America, and also in Latin America. I think let me stop at this point. Thank you very much.
I thank Mr. Azra for his presentation, for underscoring the importance of interfaith and intrafaith dialogue in creating a culture of mutual respect, and also for setting out his views on the role Indonesia could play in nurturing peace between Palestinians and Israelis. The next speaker for this session is Mrs. Wendy Pullan, head of the department and senior lecturer in the history and philosophy of architecture at the Department of Architecture at Cambridge University. She directed the Conflict in Cities, Architecture and Urban Order in Divided Jerusalem, funded by the Economic and Social Council of the UK. Her research focuses on meaning and change within urban conditions, both historical and contemporary. She has lived and thought in Jerusalem for 13 years. Madam, you have the floor.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, colleagues, and guests. I'm delighted to be here this morning and would like to thank the organizers for the invitation to speak. The topic of my talk this morning is Jerusalem in context. Now, I say that to start with because I was asked to speak on examples of post-conflict urban spaces and existing multi-communal entities. Now, that's a rather difficult topic in Jerusalem today, that as the violence increases at this point, there are not a lot of obvious communal spaces. So I consider the topic a challenge as much as anything else. But in addressing it, I think that it's important to look at the city in terms of not just the conditions today, but perhaps possibilities for the future. And therefore, I think it has to be seen in a wider context. This has been the basis of my work for many years. The top image that you see there is a set of comparative maps of different divided cities in Europe and the Middle East. I don't have time to go into the details of how those are divided, but I think you can see from the images, each one looks very different from the other. I think that it's important to note that ethno-national and religious conflicts exist in many places today, and if anything, we're finding more conflicted cities rather than less. I think there's two points to be raised. One is that conflicts have changed. We're no longer looking at straightforward wars where war is declared, fought, and eventually there's some sort of treaty and wars end. Conflicts today tend very often to come from within cities, within countries, and they wax and they wane, but they go on sometimes for a very long and indefinite period of time. The other thing is that cities have become the new arena for conflict. Even if the conflicts are based on state or national issues, we're finding that they're played out in cities, and that changes the nature of the conflict. I think it's important to realize that cities are not states, and they're not simply smaller states. They're completely different entities. Again, that's a big question. It's probably another lecture in itself, but I think that it's important to say that cities need to be treated differently than states if we're going to look at them in an effective manner. So that the comparative value of cities is significant. And this is, I think, important, particularly as conflicts become more globalized. Now, if we look at this map of Jerusalem, and it's probably quite a familiar map to many in the room, but I still want to make the point that what we're looking at here is not really a divided city. Because of the Israeli planning policy that has taken place since 1967, what we're looking at is a highly fragmented city. The division between 1948 and 1967, which you see by the green line between West and East Jerusalem, has been changed radically because of the settlement policy in East Jerusalem. On this map, the settlements are marked in gray and the Palestinian areas in a beige color. And so what we see is almost a patchwork of the different communities built primarily so that there's continuity of Jewish space and so that Palestinian areas of habitation cannot spread laterally. The red lines on the map are bypass roads that connect the settlements. So what we're looking at is a very, very complicated and fragmented picture on the ground. And I think what we see here is a situation that cannot simply be redivided again without creating a very dangerous situation that would cause a lot of bloodshed. So ultimately, whatever happens between Palestine and Israel, whether it's one state, two states, or whatever, we're looking at a city that cannot simply be redivided. that's a fact on the ground in the terms that the Israelis use to state their case. But in any case, this is what we're looking at according to this map. Now, first of all, I think I'd like to say, in the work that we've done, the comparative work looking at conflicted cities in Europe and the Middle East, is that divided cities do not flourish. We don't find any examples of divided cities flourishing in any sort of way. Now, I think it's important to realize that cities are built on the fault lines of culture, places of trade, places where different religions came together, and we've just heard about how that's happened in Indonesia. That is characteristic of cities, and what that means is it breeds both diversity and conflict. It's not a case of diversity or conflict, it's diversity and conflict. When there is violence, I would say that the use of walls and other sorts of barriers to divide cities is usually an act of despair. And you can understand why it's done. When people are killing each other, barriers go up very quickly. But these sorts of barriers, divisions, borders, buffer zones, whatever you call them, in some cases very, very large roads, like we see here in Beirut, which are put in to divide communities, these things create a lot of long-term problems. First of all, what is usually understood to be temporary very often turns out to be permanent. The exclusion of one community from another fosters isolation and very, very often vilification. You think about your side of the border, me, my people, and that we are different and somehow better than those on the other side of the border. There's been a lot of sociological research that attests to that. We get what I've called a condition of frontier urbanism, and that's the confrontation of civilian populations, not armies, but civilian populations, facilitated by spatial planning and structures. When we get divisions in cities, like we see in the bottom image of the map of Nicosia, we get irrevocable spatial changes. The cities are changed because of the imposed borders, and it becomes very, very difficult to knit the cities back together again. I think we also have examples, certainly Jerusalem is one of them, of when you have divisions in cities that eventually more extreme conflicts erupt. So there are a number of reasons why cities should not be divided. Now, the other side of this discussion has to do with the nature of public space. That when we study divided cities, We tend to do demographic studies, and we usually look at them in terms of residential areas, where it is that people live, and that's our picture of cities. The map that I just showed you of Jerusalem is a map of that sort. However, what this neglects is the fact that public space is key to city life. Public space can be violent, and it can be risky. But this is where populations encounter each other. And public space is necessary in cities. And I quote myself here, but it's something that I think is a rather important feature of cities all over the world. And that is that the benefits of plurality may be debated, but as a primary quality of modern cities, it is sine qua non for a city to be a city. It must be seen in such terms. So a city is not a city without being plural, without having multiculturalism in it. Public space suffers when conflicts become intense and prolonged. There's no question about that. One of the first things that goes in cities is a vital public space if there is a lot of violence in that city. And the various communities shrink back into their own areas. But at the same time, there is the propensity of urban populations to fill public space. And so we're looking at two examples, one right in the center of Jerusalem on the top, one at the wall in Bethlehem, two different urban conditions, one in a period of very high violence, one in a period of prolonged conflict, but where some form of ordinary life is going on. And I think we have to understand the nature of cities, how it is that people come together, how it is that they move apart from each other to begin to look at the problems with a more profound understanding of how we begin to address those problems. Now, I want to take one example of what can be we can begin to understand as communal space. Now, it's a difficult example, and it's certainly not by no means a perfect example. But I think it's an interesting one because Nicosia, of course, was a city that was divided in 1974. It remains divided with an international border going through the center of it, with Turkish Cypriots in the north and Greek Cypriots in the south. It was divided after a period of serious violence. Now, in the 1970s, talks began by the two mayors of the city, Lelos Dimitriados and Mustafa Akinji. And this was facilitated by the UN. These were major acts of resistance on behalf of both leaders. They both went against the wishes and desires and policies of their own political parties. And they did this, they made these talks in secret, and as I say, it was the UN helped them to do that. It was done with the understanding that eventually the city would be reunited, and that there had to be a long-term strategic plan in order to reunite the city properly. And the way Dimitriadis put it to me when I interviewed him is that he said that you couldn't have a situation where a market grew up on one side of the border and a six-lane inner-city motorway on the other. The city would never be able to come back together again. And so it was important that they begin to plan. And I think it's important that these talks were begun in the very darkest days of the conflict in the 1970s. By 1981, they did have a joint planning committee, and they continue with that. Now, as I say, this is by no means a perfect plan, but some of the areas that they have been able to work together on have been infrastructural. The city needed a new sewage system, and that's not something that could be done just on one side of the city. I mean, sewage doesn't know borders, and so this was rather important. Another area was the image of the city, one of the features of divided cities is that each side only maps its own side of the city. The planners decided to map both sides of the city and make it very, very public, and there's signs like the one we see here on the right-hand side all over the city. And the other thing is the plan itself spawned efforts, mainly by youth, to start to develop common spaces. One of the most interesting ones is called the Home for Cooperation, and that is right on the border area of the city. And this is very much a grass-level sort of effort that's being made. The border still remains, and there are many problems in the city, but these are some of the efforts that have been developed. And so that if we summarize the Nicosia Master Plan and some of the related projects, I think it's important to see that there was long-term thinking in it, that there was neutral facilitation that helped, but it didn't replace the local parties in any sort of way. There were different types and different levels of initiatives. They used small actions when large actions would not work, but they did develop a lot of these small initiatives. There was the spawning of private initiatives and community initiatives through the larger master plan, but they actually were not part of the master plan itself. public space has been a default position. It has been understood by the planners that public space is important, if extremely difficult and often risky. And there has been a very strong focus on the nature of urban life rather than simply a political solution here. So if we return to Jerusalem, which of course has nothing like this going on right now, but if I'm asked, where would you begin to look for a place where people might begin to come together in some form? And it might be very, very minimal at this point. I mean, in my opinion, in a place like Jerusalem that is heavily contested and there's a lot of distrust and hatred, I think it's important simply for Israelis and Palestinians to see each other occasionally. There are very few Israelis at this point who even hear Arabic, and I think it's important that they hear Arabic. The Palestinians do tend to hear more Hebrew than Arabic because they're subject to the occupying force. So if we begin to look at what image of the city there is, I think it needs to be realistic, and it's something that people need to look at much more than they do, that this is a highly divided city right now. It's a city where settlements dominate the east illegally. There is a light rail system, a tram system, that has been built going through the city. And you see it, and it's the dotted line that starts in West Jerusalem. It goes to the old city, and then it goes north. And it links the two of the main settlements into the center of Jerusalem and West Jerusalem. So this is not an innocent map, and nor is the light rail an innocent piece of infrastructure. This is done in order to promote the occupation. However, the light rail has been something that in more peaceful times was used by a fairly large number of Palestinians, and their attitudes towards the light rail has diverged in different sorts of ways. Some people have used it. They feel that it is something that is owed to them by the Israeli authorities. Other people won't touch it. However, with the more recent violence, the light rail has been a target of attacks, and Palestinians have generally now shied away from using the light rail. So it's become a very, very prominent part of Jerusalem imagery. For better or worse, I feel that that's important. It's something that has become symbolic both of the possibilities of division and the possibilities of some sort of common ground and shared facility, just simply through a resource in the city. So I would look at that as a long-term possibility. And partly because it goes through one of the key areas in the city at Damascus Gate. You'll see on my map on the left-hand side, this is where the new city meets the old city. It's also where the border between 1948 and 1967 fell. It's still very, very much a border area. This is what I mean about it, the difficulty of knitting cities back together again from an urban point of view. Since 1967, a large inner city motorway has gone in, and that further cements the border area. However, one of the main tram stops are there. There's a lot of space. There's actually quite a lot of activity, of economic activity, of people moving in and out and goods being moved in and out of the old city. And it is one of the most obvious places for some sort of large transportation node. And we know from looking at other cities, transport and railway stations, transportation nodes are relatively neutral spaces. This is where people do encounter each other, and I'm taking public space in its broadest understanding at this point as a possibility. So that if we look at what this might give us, it's an example perhaps of some sort of interaction, some form of common ground. location is important. It's a border location, a place of importance, and as I say, it's become a place of symbolic importance, for better or for worse. It's secular, and it's strongly secular in a city that is really loaded with religious meaning and claims, and that at least lessens the possibility, I think, for contestation in certain ways. It's certainly public or potentially public, and it combines a public space with a necessary infrastructure. And it could perhaps eventually become a resource that could be enjoyed fully by Palestinians. This is a long shot. I mean, I'm not trying to promote something that is going to happen tomorrow, but you know, if we're looking for possibilities in Jerusalem, I would say this is one of the places to look. So in conclusion, can we speak about common space? Well, it is a very, very difficult problem today in Jerusalem. And I mean, certainly the current violence and Israel's long-term intransigence means that there's very little hope for common space right now. But does that mean we should not look at all? No, because as I said before, in terms of the city, public space is key. And that is something that we still have to focus on in the long term. Timing is critical. We found in looking at many divided cities, outbreaks of violence tend to be episodic. There are cycles of conflict, and that has to be addressed properly. Sometimes there's more conflict and more violence, sometimes less. I think there's no question today that there is ethnic cleansing going on. This is a reality that will have to be dealt with and has been noted yesterday, is that there needs to be international protection for Palestinians now. But on the other hand, if the international community is going to be more involved and wants to work in a way that is useful, I think it has to go beyond what do we do now, and there has to be this strategic thinking in terms of the future. I don't think that's simply a matter of solving the problem through a political solution. Even if there was a political solution tomorrow, there would not be a city. The city is too badly damaged at this point. And so the city has to be taken into account, and we have to find ways where we begin to look at the damage in the city and begin to address it and engage with it as a damaged city. Thank you very much.
I would like to thank Mrs. Pullan for joining us today. Your expertise on urban conditions and of Jerusalem and the implications for coexistence and stability among communities has certainly benefited our participants here today, and I'm certain will enrich our deliberations. Before we start our discussion, let me introduce to you our discussant, Ms.Tova Norlen, visiting fellow at Johns Hopkins University School of Advanced International Studies in Washington, D.C. Ms. Norlen has been working on issues related to international security, Middle East, Israel, conflict management, bargaining and negotiations, and U.S. foreign policy. She is currently also working on a book on negotiating conflict over sacred territory, which will be published with the University of Georgia Press. The title is Sacred Stones and Religious Nuts, Negotiating Territorial Absolutes. Ms. Norlen will make a few comments on the presentations we just heard, which will hopefully stimulate our discussion. Madam, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chairman. Can you hear me? Thank you, my friends, distinguished delegates and our organizers. And thank you also the panelists for three excellent presentations, very colorful and informative. My job as a discussant is to draw out some of the most important elements in brought up by the speakers, but I also hope to add a little bit of my own perspective to the table. And I will begin with an anecdote. I spent my formative years in the 1980s in Jerusalem, so I know the city very well, and the space and the spaces and both sides of the city is very close to my heart. I lived in a house, in fact, that was built on the strip of no man's land between East and West Jerusalem. If I walked right and passed over the old minefield where there was a roaming camel, I could go to West Jerusalem and connect where the buses connected to West Jerusalem, where I went to school and I would go out with my friends at night. If I walked left, I could hop on to the Arab transportation system and the service taxis that came in from Ramallah and went to the Damascus gates. Depending on where I was going in the city was the direction I chose when I walked out of my front door. But it was also very different worlds, and it required different clothes, different makeup, different jewelry, and even personalities. I even had carried two pairs of sunglasses to fit in these two different cultures. As we have heard these past 2 days, Jerusalem, like the rest of Palestine, is a story of loss. The stories are familiar to us who know Jerusalemites. The Habash family lived downstairs from us. They were three elderly sisters who, of Christian Palestinians, who had a former home in the German colony, one of the areas that Palestinians had to leave in 1967, I believe, yes. 48, sorry. Menachem would know because he lives there. They told the typical story that Menachem tells us of Arab Jews who were their neighbors until those other Zionist Jews started coming in and destroyed the harmony. This is a circle of loss, suffering, and dispossession from land that's so common to ethnic conflicts around the world. We see it in Kosovo, Beirut, Bosnia, and Nicosia, where violence has driven identities apart, where each side has managed to delete a long history of coexistence from their collective memories. So we look back to this coexistence in the past to try to revert, and we long to revert to that time. But unfortunately, the construction of conflicting identities is so much easier than their deconstruction. While we need to study and know how these hardened identities were created, it's important to note that these polarized identities we have now are not the sum of their parts. In other words, we cannot just subtract the barriers and reverse the events in order to go back to a harmonious Jerusalem, which Wendy noted. Nor can we erase the experiences, the feelings of belonging, and the territorial attachments of those people who now inhabit the places that Palestinians lost. And that's especially true, unfortunately, for the most religious radical settler groups, who are now generations in the same place, and who truly see the land as their sacred, exclusive homeland. The ingredients in the equation of coexistence have changed so much that you also need to change the formula to resolve it. Menachem makes the case that the narratives of both Palestinians and Jewish identities were shaped through the lens of conflict. Golda Meir's famous question, "Who are the Palestinians?" was a reflection of the Jewish belief or rhetoric, depending on how we choose to understand it, that there was a void of local identities and that Palestinian identity was created merely as an anti-Zionist response. Menachem shows very effectively that there was a highly relevant Palestinian identity, perhaps even nationalism, that encompassed both Arab and Palestinian, Arab and Jewish Palestinians at the time. And that when we're analyzing history through the perspective of conflict, we fail to see the identities created by people on the ground. But beyond shaping our historical lens, conflict also shapes our current culture by forgetting the past. In the case of Palestinians under Israeli occupation, local identities were suppressed by Israel and never allowed to bloom. but it's also always the propriety of outsiders in the case of historic Palestine, or the highest authorities of the three faiths. Just think of the Christian nativity story that takes place in a Western-style barn rather than in a Palestinian home where local, where animals and people, according to local historic traditions. Who has ever heard of Palestinians not welcoming their family to their homes when Joseph and Mary went to their hometown to be registered? And nobody has written about the local culture of minorities, for instance, in Bethlehem, where family trees often go back 500 years, and where some families, as the settlers are very fond of explaining, may clearly be descendants of Jews. This history, as Menachem has noted, is not preserved the way it would have been in peacetime. But whether we believe that the Palestinian nationalism that we see today emerged as a reaction to anti-Zionist or as a result of a more organic process, I don't think it could have sustained itself, or it's sure that it could not have sustained itself, had it not been for the rootedness that Palestinians feel, just like other Middle Easterners in their territory. The history of Palestine is first and foremost territorial. It's a story of land gained and lost and then redeemed, depending on who you are, right? In fact, Judaism is the best example of the importance of territory, where in the Torah, it tells the story of Abraham, who, after arriving in Hebron, had to bury his wife Sarah, who died at 127 years old. Rather than accepting the land that is now the Cave of the Patriarchs as a gift from Ephron the Hittite, Abraham persisted on paying for it in full, 400 shekels. Why? Because once you have purchased a piece of land for money, ownership cannot be questioned, supposedly. So thus, while Palestinian identity has been shaped in large part by their opposition to Israel, it's also very deeply rooted, in contrast to what Israelis often believe, in their homeland territory. So Menachem, I'd like you to address the issue of deconstruction of the hardened, polarized identities created by conflict, keeping in mind a possible future negotiation process and with a lens to the past. With the polarization of identities and the establishment of facts on the ground, we now have generations of religious Israelis who may become just as militant as their jihadi counterparts. The denial of the heritage and claims of belonging of the other is stronger than ever on both sides. Often it's based on religious convictions. As much as we'd like to, these attachments are not going to go away, but are bound to become even stronger in Israel as Israel's demographics changes. How can we transcend the polarized two-state solution, which is polarizing, where territory has to be divided and claims have to be renounced, for a more creative solution where heritage is respected and honored, but residence is not denied to those who are already living on the land? Can creative solutions be worked into a two-state solution where both sides can agree that they're living on land that's also sacred to others? Can the land be sovereign to one nation but under the custodianship of another, as Victor Catan argued yesterday? For Wendy, let's go back to Jerusalem for a moment and to your important work there. And I'll give you another anecdote. An Israeli friend of mine once did guard duty in the Old City in one of those high guard towers overlooking the Temple Mount. It was absolutely stunning, breathtaking up there. But what I discovered there was that in Jerusalem, we don't just have a two-dimensional problem of territory, but a multi-dimensional or even three-dimensional problem. Just like the state has built settler access roads, there's a system, albeit unofficial, in both Jerusalem and Hebron, where settlers have taken control of the roofs, the rooftops, not only for guard towers or guarding duty, but as access roads. In order to get to the yeshivas in the midst of the Muslim quarter, you have to travel. You travel from rooftop to rooftop until you reach your desired roof, and then you drop down to your destination as if the bustling streets below don't even exist. Different world. So I'm interested in how we can go from this realization of what we had in the past to what we need for the future. Wendy talks about post-conflict scenarios, and you did add a little bit more detail in your presentation here than you had in your paper, but I'm interested in how we can reverse the separation that's been caused by decades of physical and psychological barriers. She mentioned that mentions that we need to focus on practical measures as well as the long-term post-conflict context rather than just on the short-term negotiation needs. But with physical barriers also come new narratives, new enemy images, and revisions of history, the us versus them scenario. Once you construct these narratives, once you internalize the losses, the suffering, and the sunk costs that have gone into the construction of national identities, they become very difficult to deconstruct. There are very few examples where it's succeeded in the past, if any. So how do you address this in the negotiation context in order to create something new that can be acceptable for all sides? Another question that I have for Wendy is about the flourishing of divided cities. You argue that divided cities do not flourish, in other words, not like they used to in the past. This is interesting, but also a little contradictory when discussing the possible solutions for Jerusalem, because we talk about the needs of a Palestinian state. When we talk about these needs, we're talking about the possibility of at least a nominal division of the city in order for the Palestinian part to flourish as the capital of an independent Palestinian state, not as a united city with Israel. They also say good fences make good neighbors, right? And many believe that there needs to be a separation which removes the occupation and the usurpation of land in order for future peace to work. If we're going to learn anything from the past, the first step needs to be to accept the dual identity of the territory. The fact that there are historical claims that underlie today's territorial attachments, also for Jews, is and should be, I think, even in this forum, as inalienable as the rights of the Palestinians. There are, regardless of whose rights the territory belongs to, attachments, emotional attachments. Further, as much as we say that this is not a religious conflict, but a political one, we also have to understand that emotional attachment to territory is sacred for both sides, and that those who are most extreme will use their religion to take action. Religion, therefore, also needs to be part of the solution, as Mr. Azra has suggested. So as a final point, I'd like to challenge perhaps this conference, its distinguished delegates, and the committee members themselves to ask a quite controversial question that's not really ever addressed. What good does the letter of international law do if it will suck us into another 60 years of status quo and conflict, including dispossession, suffering, and expulsion? An implementation of international law in this case, at this point in time, would either have to be forced upon Israel or would lead most probably to a civil war in Israel. And as long as nothing changes in the constellation of international power politics, and believe me, I live four blocks away from the US Capitol, so I know it won't, this simply cannot be done. Knowing this, how can we work with what we have now and what we know from the past to create a better future? Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Norlen, for your analysis. You already directed a number of questions to our panelists. However, before handing it over to them, I would like to take a few comments and questions from the audience. So I will open up the floor, and please identify yourselves at the beginning and make your interventions as brief as possible. We need to wrap this session up in the next 30 minutes. So the first speaker, yes, the gentleman in red.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I wonder why we are talking about the question of Jerusalem as a topic for this international conference. We should be thinking of the future or solutions. We have heard about the past very well, very nostalgic, but little about the future in shaping of Jerusalem in the future. It is nostalgic to listen to Mr. Merhim about the how the Jews and Muslims lived together in Jerusalem pre-1948. We are happy to hear Mr. Azra talking about the pluralism and multiculturalism in Indonesia, and Miss Pullan about the future of the city. But we know for certain that one state solution or Jerusalem being capital of two state solution is an impossibility. The Jews, Israel will make sure that it will not happen. So, what is the solution? I think it must go back to the pre-1948. Jerusalem must be made into a city for the Jews and Muslims. No East, no West. That's my view. And as I said, we have heard so much about the past, little in the future. That I want comments from the panel. I'm Pahamin from Global Peace Foundation, Malaysia.
Thank you very much for your comments. And now we have a question from the distinguished ambassador of Jordan. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much. Just to limit, thank the panelists for excellent presentations. I would limit my intervention to the Professor Azra. As a matter of fact, dialogue is very important. It is always good between enemies, between friends. You give you the perspective of the other. However, having said that, the issue of Palestine, the cause of the problem is not religion. It is now political, legal. The Palestinian people have made the ultimate sacrifice and the compromise, and we have passed this kind of stage of having dialogue. It is good to have dialogue, but this is not the issue per se. The issue is to implement the formula agreed by the international community, Security Council resolutions, both parties to have two-state solutions. And I think this is the focus should be here. What is always, frankly speaking, that sometimes a little bit annoying when we said just these people who loving peace should put the pressure on both parties or on both leaders of two people. Put the pressure on Palestinians on what? They have sacrificed 78%. They follow Oslo process. The pressure should be on Israelis, on the government of Israel, on this right-wing government to deliver on its promise, to be abide by the international law, to be implement the UN resolutions, to go back to the formula everybody agreed upon. It is not a matter of just having this dialogue, though dialogue is very important regardless. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And Mr. Kadang.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thanks for the speakers. I would like to ask Mr. Klein that Palestinians, those they expelled from their homes and houses, let me give you an example of Lifta. The owners of the houses, they're still there, 2 kilometers away from their houses, from their lands. and there is laws doesn't allow them to go back. You spoke about the 74 letter or something like that. They are waiting for, you know, Palestinians to go back. This man, you know, the Mukhtar, he spoke about that. And there are houses that still remains and in good conditions. In Katamon, and the families and the owners, they still in the East Jerusalem and around, and they don't allow them to go back to their homes. What do you say about that? And what's your position regarding the right of return to the Palestinian refugees to their homes and to their land? Thank you.
Thank you. I will take one final question. Yes, the gentleman at the back, please announce yourself and keep it brief, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Nur Munir, University of Indonesia. Thank you, speakers. Mr. Menachem has elaborated the romanticism alive in the Jerusalem prior to 1948. The year of the establishment of the modern state of Israel. And we have heard also the elaboration of the hope of the future of Jerusalem from Ms. Wendy Pullan, the example of the past conflicts, urban spaces, and existing multi-communal entities. These are our hopes to restate the situations in the past where the state, city of Jerusalem coexists peacefully in different entities. We would love to thanks to Mr. Azumarti Azra, who tried to give example of the multiculturalism of Indonesia and harmony, and it's a we understand that Mr. Azumarti Azra would love to introduce to the audience example of living peacefully in harmony among diversity. I would love to turn the name of City of Jerusalem, which is rooted from the two words, that is Ir Shalom, City of Peace. The title of City of Peace, Ir Shalom, and become Yerushalayim, is supposedly the City of Peace and city, not City of War. How to maintain this title and this entity is the obligation of all parties, especially religious people among Jewish, Christian and Muslim. And we understand that in this city of Shalom, today is divided by four quarters. There's a Jewish quarters, Muslim quarters, Armenian quarter, and Christian quarter. This is our obligation to maintain the peace in that city. And all of those religious people from the Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, hold the obligation of the keeping peace in this city. As I would love to allude the command of Jewish Tanakh, for the Jews is obliged by God to honor its neighbor, at, as it states in the Torah, written in the book of Leviticus 19, verses 33 and 34, it states...
Sir, kindly conclude. Thank you.
What my conclusion is that I would like to allude in this room the message of God, state for Jews and order and for Muslim, lastly. There's a state... Wekiyakur etcha, kir piartsechim, lo tonu oto. Keezra michem yihye lachem hakir. Hakir etchem
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I believe we have questions addressed to each of our panelists, so I will start, I think, from the left, including the ones put to us by our distinguished discussant. So I will go left to right, and I will start with Wendy.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. There were a number of points raised here. One is about the verticality of the city, and this is absolutely true, but it's not simply that there are settlers on the rooftops. The settlers are building a whole tunnel system underneath the old city and then going south of the old city into the area called Silwan that we looked at yesterday briefly. It's difficult to understand what this city below the city is meant to be. I think the settlers on the rooftops are there, usually with arms and clear view lines into important strategic areas like the Haram al-Sharif. The underground areas, though, are used for all sorts of things, from tourism to prayer areas to archaeological sites to visitor centers. The effect it has on the Palestinians, though, is that it sandwiches them. And this is a very uncomfortable effect for the Palestinians, to have hostile settlers above on the rooftops and below in the tunnels. And Palestinians are mostly at street level and a few floors above that, but they're getting pressed, squashed almost, between the settlers on the top and the bottom. It's a naturally vertical city because it's a very old city and it's very archaeological, but this has been turned into an aspect of the conflict, and I will say it's a very worrying concern because of the physical nature of it. This is not something that is just going to be removed in any sort of easy way. I think that the whole question of a so-called post-conflict scenario is a difficult one. Personally, I never use the term post-conflict. I think every city has conflict. The question really is, to what extent can conflict be channeled in constructive ways, and to what extent does it get out of hand, become unbalanced like we see in an occupation, or become overly violent? So I think post-conflict is a very problematic term. As I tried to get across in my talk, I think public space is always key, though, for the proper functioning of a city, and it's something that simply has to be nurtured. Now, so we come back to then divided cities not flourishing. In my research, which has looked at about 12 heavily contested cities, we do not see divided cities that flourish. Sometimes it may mean the end of hostilities, but the cities themselves, over time, do not flourish as cities. And that tends to build up problems amongst the residents and certain distrusts and hatreds of people on the other side, or ignorance of them. And so I think that in the long term is problematic. And so we come back to public space as being the other side of that. I think finally to say that is this a religious conflict or is it a political conflict? Well, I think it's obviously both. And one of the things that we've seen in the heightened violence over the past years is when religion and politics are brought together. And so it becomes a religio-political conflict, and in that sense becomes much more intense, much more emotional, and I think much more problematic. One possible scenario would be that if Jerusalem were to be an open city for the three religions and the political capitals removed to Tel Aviv and Ramallah. It's a possibility.
Yeah, I think actually my answer has been conveyed by Wendy. Actually, of course, originally this Israeli-Palestinian conflict was political, of course. But you know, in the course of time, you cannot. It is become more and more difficult to distinguish religious and political and religious conflicts from time to time. In fact, in among the Israelis as well as among the Palestinians, there are groups that use religious justification for their action. In fact, not only in Palestine and Israel, but also even in Indonesia, the group who support the Palestinians, you know, use religious doctrine, certain verses of the Quran. You know. Even though the Indonesian government do not use the does not support Palestinian based on religious motif, for instance. Indonesia support the independence of Palestine simply because that is the mandate of Indonesia as a state since 1945, as stated in the preamble of Indonesian constitution. But still, there are groups in Indonesia. So it is quite strange, in Indonesia in this case. Of course, there are a number of countries in the Middle East, like Egypt, Jordan, also Turkey, that have diplomatic relation with Israel. But it is very difficult. Even when President Wahid proposed that we should open trade relation with Israel rather than by way of Singapore, and then he was opposed bitterly on religious reason. On religious ground, on Islamic ground. So again, this is it is very difficult. Even I always argue that the Palestinian struggle actually is not Islamic struggle in general. It is based on Palestinian nationalism, that you have in the Palestinian struggle, Fatah and also Hamas. And there are also Christians among the leadership of Palestinians. So it is not appropriate to use Islamic symbol in this context to claim that the struggle of the Palestinian is basically Islamic struggle. But again, this is the problem, the complication, particularly in Indonesia. That's why it is very difficult for Indonesia, except they continue to support Palestinians, but at the same time, we try also to mediate between conflicting parties, even among the Palestinians. Thank you.
Okay, regarding nostalgia and romanticism, I'm very thankful for raising these questions, and I'm very sorry if I sounded romanticist or nostalgic. I'm not. It's impossible to go back to the past. The past is what is a foreign country, as the title of the famous book is. But it's necessary for us to study the past and to confront our tendency towards amnesia and to forget the past. I tried in my presentation to state that Jews and Arabs both were Palestinians. And Palestinian identity was developed jointly by Jews and Arabs, I mean Palestinian identity, local patriotism in its local and modern, the modern concept of local patriotism was developed jointly by Jews and Arabs since the late 19th century, early 20th century. Zionism came from outside, But when Zionism came, there was their local patriotism shared by Jews and Arabs. But it's today, unfortunately, the two national movements divided ethnically between the past two partners, and each of the two national movements claim exclusive attachment to the land. This is the tragedy, and we have to explore the joint past in order to reshape our present and build a different future. So we live now in an era, too long era, of a mutual denial of the other side attachment to the land. What we need to change is to see the other as the other side attachment to the land, that the other side belongs to Palestine, and Palestine belongs to all of its ethnic groups and communities and residents. So Jerusalem of today belongs to all of its citizens and communities. So this we can learn from the past and not deny our joint past. But definitely there is no way to go back to what was there before 48. Now regarding the refugees, definitely Israel implements double standards in Jerusalem. Jews are allowed to claim and get back their homes in Sheikh Jarrah or Muslim Quarter. The Palestinians cannot, even the Jerusalemite Palestinians in East Jerusalem cannot get back their properties in Katamon or Musrara, for instance. So the right of return, Israel exercises right of return to Jews only. And I do think that it needs to be changed. And this double standard is very typical to the Israeli the political behavior or Israeli legal system. There are two different legal systems in the West Bank and the occupied West Bank and Jerusalem, and this is part of the profile of the Israeli ruling system over East Jerusalem and the West Bank, and this should be changed. The challenge is, our challenge is, let's say, as scholars and professionals, is how the two sides can share Jerusalem. I don't like to speak about dividing Jerusalem. I would like to suggest sharing Jerusalem without killing the two cities, Al-Quds and Yerushalayim. That's the challenge. And definitely this challenge starts when the peace treaty or the peace agreement between the politicians signed. So the challenge must be met, and for many years after signing the peace treaty, the problems will not end with the signing of a peace. Jerusalem is a very, very big challenge. To urbanists, to historians, to religious people, to believers, and so on, and we have to look forward how to make it without killing the two cities.
Thank you. I believe we have time for one or two very brief interventions from the floor. Before I invite the panelists for telegraphic reactions and concluding remarks, if any. So I have the distinguished ambassador of Palestine.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. You know, I was reluctant to take the floor because I believe that I will be making a statement shortly in the closing session. But having said that, and also, of course, sharing the sentiment of thanking all the panelists for their presentations, I was intrigued by, you know, the very appropriate remarks made by the facilitator, and I think that she was on the right track in raising all the very good points that she raised. But let me also say that for those who say that the city cannot be divided, I don't think that some of these sentiments, which are subjective, cannot sometimes withstand the test of reality. When this recent uprising of the Palestinian youth, which is still unfolding, which started in Jerusalem, this facade and pretension that the city is eternally united, as it has been claimed by the Israeli occupying authorities and government, it did not, you know, survive the span of 2 weeks. They say that the old city of Jerusalem, as an example, is a ghost town. Nobody would go to it. The mayor of West Jerusalem and the Jewish settlers of East Jerusalem, he called Jews who have permits and who are not members of the army to carry weapons and to create an additional militia to defend the Jews from his perspective. And, you know, he was calling for establishing a vigilante militia group. The Prime Minister of Israel isolated communities in East Jerusalem, such as Sur Baher, Shafat, and other places, and they, in fact, erected walls around them and restricted the Palestinians of East Jerusalem to enter and leave these communities only from one gate and to be, searched or examined by Israeli security authorities. A debate ensued within the Israeli government whether to deprive communities of Kfar Aqab and other areas of their identity cards. They did not want them to be Jerusalemites. I'm just giving examples about the reality as it was unfolding, regardless of how we as experts, diplomats, academicians can debate issues, but we have to pay attention to the reality on the ground, and then the reality on the ground, after 50 years of occupation, unilateral illegal annexation by the Israeli government, then in a span of 2 weeks, the city that we thought, or some thought that it was united, all of a sudden, it is living the life of being divided. So I thought that this issue should be raised. The other issue is that, you know, it was raised that in order to understand reality today and what should be done with regard to Jerusalem, and for that matter, occupation and the end of occupation, including East Jerusalem, one should study the past. Good enough. But it is often by some, particularly on the Israeli side, they select a certain moment in the past and they start from it. So it becomes a convenient for them. They select maybe a moment in 1919 or 1920, or for that matter, it might be 1860. Why not 1601? Why not 1200? Why not when the Nisebi family more than 1,000 years ago became the custodians of the Church of the Holy Sepulchres and being the custodian of the key? At what point do we start history? Should we start from the Canaanite even before the arrival, you know, of Prophet Abraham from Mesopotamia? Why not? Should we start, you know, from the moment, you know, when a new religion emerged of Christianity about 2,000 years ago? Why not we should start maybe when Khalifa Omar came, you know, and had the covenant of Khalifa Omar with the, you know, the Christian leader, in which, you know, that the Muslims would control the city and respect the religious activities in that city. Where do we start? When does history start? Does history start from the rise of nationalism in Europe about 200 years ago, when Zionism emerged as a result of the crimes that were committed in Europe by Europeans and discrimination against them that led to the emergence of Zionism as a product of nationalism? When do we start? You know, what historical moment do we start from? The last, you know, comment that I want to make is, now, regardless of how things were created in Palestine before 1948, let's say maybe 40 years before 1948, and after 48, and after 1967, and now there is, by some Israelis, not all, attachment, the so-called attachment of the two sides to the land. I would say that for me as a Palestinian, Palestine is my homeland. It was the homeland of my father, my grandfather. I can give you the tree of my family. I can go to hundreds of years ago. But the evolution in the Palestinian thinking, we will never deny the fact that Palestine is our national homeland. But our political thinking developed into accepting in our national homeland two states. One of them is Israel. That is a remarkable political evolution in our thinking. What we see today in Israel is a denial of our feeling and our narrative. And not only that they have a relative, they can have whatever narrative they want, but they are trying to impose on us a narrative that we do not belong to this land. It is their Jewish national homeland. And we are, I don't know what we are, according to them. And they will be so generous to us that they might allow us to live in certain parts of this land that is there. And of course, what we see today in Israel is a serious contradiction between the nationalist Zionist of the last 100-150 years and the emergence of extremist Jewish groups who are now pushing the exclusive Jewish agenda. And from that perspective, we have to look about their thinking vis-a-vis Jerusalem, which I will dwell on that later on when I give my closing remarks. Thank you.
Thank you. We are approaching the end of this session. I would like to ask whether any of our panelists have any very brief concluding remarks. In 1 minute.
Yes, okay. Ambassador Mansour, I'm very thankful for your remarks. The question is, in my view, is not where we start, which point, which year we start, but what is the principle element that accordingly we look on history and we learn the past. The question is whether the past is used to empower exclusive claims or inclusive principles. Okay, that's the question. So each side can
you should give the answer to it.
No, of course inclusive. Of course inclusive. Okay. I invite you to read my book, and I start. The description. I start the narrative prior to Zionism in order to show that Jaffa was, for instance, and Haifa and Jerusalem and Hebron were Palestinian cities, and we tend to ignore that Palestinians has attachment to Jaffa, for instance, or to deny the Palestinian attachment to Jaffa, and to see, and I show how it is made by Israeli authorities on the ground, how we deny the Palestinian existence in West Jerusalem, for instance, or in Jaffa, or other places. So the principle is, the key issue is whether we look on Palestine as shared, as inclusive, as belong to all its citizens and communities, or it is exclusive. That's the key question. In my view, the answer is very clear. It is my principle is inclusive, and this is the main lesson that we should learn from history.
Thank you. Wendy?
Yes. Yeah, I mean, I think it's absolutely clear that Jerusalem today is not a united city under Israel. This is an Israeli myth, and I think there are probably fewer and fewer Israelis who are believing the myth, and particularly in the very recent years. My point about the city today is that it's not a divided city, but it is a fragmented city. And that is a result of long-term Israeli planning. Whether it was anticipated, whether that backfired, that's a long discussion, and it's really quite difficult to know exactly what was anticipated beyond this Israeli idea of a united city. My concern about dividing the city, besides the fact that it would make a very bad city, and that is not based on particularly a subjective understanding, and this is based on research of many divided cities. But beyond that is that the way things are going right now, that is, if there is a division because of the Israeli position, which is one of power at this point, and a fair amount of influence, I would be afraid that the city would be divided in a way that would give the Palestinians a very small portion of the city, which would not make a satisfactory city for the Palestinians. And so I would resist division at this point, because I think it will not work out well at all. And that's a real problem.
Thank you. And a very final comment, please.
Just to underscore Wendy here, I had a very similar point. I think it's important to recognize the power disparity here, and that Jewish Israelis don't need East Jerusalem to flourish. It's a thorn in their side, especially for Orthodox Jews who want to pray at the temple at the Western Wall. So I think while it would be lovely to create an open city that was open to all three faiths, the concern perhaps should be more how we can get East Jerusalem to flourish for the Palestinians in order to be there once we have an agreement for the Palestinian state. And so I think if anything needs to be communicated to the Israelis, it's the acceptance that there are dual attachments to the territories, but we also need to have that discussion on the Palestinian side, and because there are many voices still that deny this dual attachment. And I thank you, Mr. Ambassador, for those comments. I appreciate it.
Thank you. This concludes our deliberations in Plenary 2, and on behalf of the committee, I would like to express our deep appreciation to our distinguished speakers, and also to our discussant who helped our interesting exchange of views. Many thanks also goes to our participants who contributed to the discussion. We will now have a very brief coffee break of 10 minutes and continue with the closing session afterwards. And I would like to appeal to everyone to please make an effort to be back on time. A short announcement. Before, I would like to inform everyone that the vice chairman of the committee will be hosting a reception at lunch today at 12 o'clock noon outside the conference hall. The meeting is adjourned. Thank you.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention for a practical announcement, please? There will be a Palestinian cultural evening later today at Balai Sarbini in Semanggi. Transportation will be provided. Please gather at the back lobby of this hotel near the Grand Manhattan Club by 5 p.m. to go to the event together. Thank you very much.
Excellencies, distinguished colleagues, speakers, ladies and gentlemen, we have come to the end of our conference. On behalf of the Committee on the Exercise of the Inalienable Rights of the Palestinian People, I would like to thank all the participants for their presence and valuable contributions. I would certainly like also to thank Foreign Minister Retno Marsudi, Foreign Minister Riyad Al-Malki, the Secretary General of the OIC, Iyad Madani, and the Assistant Secretary General for Palestinian Affairs of the Organization of the Islamic Cooperation, Mr. Samir Bakr, for their participation at this very important meeting. We have indeed a fruitful exchange of views. I also take note the large participation by the large diplomatic community in Jakarta, civil society representatives from Palestine, Indonesia, the region, and further away, and the keen interest by the local international media, local and international media, as proof of the high priority of the international community is attaching to this issue. I also recognize the presence of students at the very end, at the back of this conference room. On behalf of the committee, allow me also to express our appreciation and thanks to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, to the Government of the Republic of Indonesia, for facilitating and for their cooperation of this very important event, especially Ambassador Hasan Klip, Mr. Andi Rahmianto, Ibu Ms. Rina Sumarno, and all the team from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And moreover, I wish also to thank the participation of Indonesian experts for their participation in this meeting. I now give the floor to Ambassador Hasan Klip, Deputy Minister for Multilateral Cooperation at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, for his concluding remarks. The floor is yours.
Thank you. His Excellency Mr. Riyad Al-Maliki, the Foreign Ministers of State of Palestine, who are here in our midst. Ambassador Disrapercaya, the Vice Chairs of the Committee on Exercise of Inalienable Rights of the Palestinian Peoples, my good friend Mr. Riyad Mansour, Ambassadors, Permanent Observer of Palestine, of the State of Palestine to the United Nations, Excellencies, members of the Bureau, all of participants, Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, and good afternoon to all of you. We have reached the end of our 2 days international conference on the question of Jerusalem. On behalf of the Government of Indonesia, in particular the Foreign Ministry of Indonesia, I wish to express our appreciations to the committee, the UN Secretariat, to the OIC for offering to us to host this international conference, and of course for closely collaborated in making this conference possible and successful. We are profoundly grateful as well to members of the committee, to resource person, to participants for their active participations as well as invaluable contribution during this today's seminar. In my view, it is suffice to say that this conference has provided invaluable forum for all of us to exchange our views pertaining to the status of Jerusalem, its historical and contemporary model for coexistence, and possible scenario for viable Jerusalem. During our discussion, I observe that we have discussed and underlined the importance attached to the protections of Jerusalem, as the holy city of three religions. Such protection must entail assurances of accessibility and freedom of movement for all Muslim, Christian, and Jews alike, as well as must ensure peaceful coexistence of all populations, regardless of their religion and nationalities. Those principles, in our view, could contribute to the creation of peaceful and viable Jerusalems. But regretfully, we all know too well that there are still persistent challenges towards securing a peaceful and viable Jerusalem. Those challenges relate to the ongoing provocative actions by Israel to forcibly and illegally alter the religious and historical character, status, and identity of Jerusalem. Let me say on a bigger picture, on the question of Palestine itself. We are all aware, and we all know too well, that the greatest obstacles to our long decade struggles and endeavors to achieve a just, lasting, comprehensive solution to the questions of Palestine is absolutely the persistent illegal policies and practices of Israel in the Palestine-occupied territory. Israel policies and practices blatantly breach international law, international human rights laws, and violations of UN resolutions, including those of UN Security Council resolutions. We have always condemned those policies and practices, and we always will, because it is not only wrong and illegal, it is also dangerous. But I think condemnation are no longer enough. And condemnation indeed is not a policy. It's an expression of frustration, expressions of dismay of the situation that we are facing. So facing those persistent illegal policy and practices, we as committee and individually need to also persistently confront them and persistently pursuing what we believe in. I think we need to continue to take concerted efforts in realizations of our Palestinian dream, in deoccupations of Palestinian territory, in establishing an independent, sovereign, viable state of Palestine, and in achieving peace and security in the region. Toward this end, we need to continue to support all endeavors in removing all main obstacles to the realizations of two-state solutions. And we thought, and we always believe in, that we need to continue to put the issue of Palestine to remain in the global center stage, particularly in the midst of the current political and security landscape in the Middle East regions. We should not let our focus on Palestine be withered. This international conference on the question of Jerusalem here, in our view, has contributed to put Palestine question back to the radar screens of the global arena. And I wish in this note to thank and express our gratitude to all our colleagues from media who are here with us for the 2 days, who have already covering and disseminating all the information about this conference. So, Excellencies, colleagues and friends, the flight of the Palestinian people has gone for far too long. And the Israelis' utter disregard of the international law has also gone for far too long. We, community, international community, must act in a more figure. And we as a committee that was established 40 years ago to deal with the exercise, to exercise the inalienable right of Palestinians, must play a stronger role in removing all hurdles, all obstacles to the establishment of a sovereign, independent, viable state of Palestine with East Jerusalem on, as its capital. Rest assured, for its part, Indonesia will always hold to its unwavering commitment, to its unconditional support in ensuring that justice and freedom for the people of Palestine prevail. So let me conclude once again, Mr. Vice Chair, to thanks and express our appreciation, our gratitude to the committee, to the UN Secretariat, to the OIC, and to all of you for being here with us, for your active participations, and most importantly, for collaborating closely with us to make this conference on Jerusalem a success, and we have not only successful, I think, but we have also come up with so many ideas, perspective, and outcome. By that, I would like once again, thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you very much, Ambassador Hassan Klip, for his closing remark, which, among other, underlines the principles on the need for the protection of East Jerusalem as well as peaceful coexistence. He also has identified challenges for securing peaceful and viable East Jerusalem. And certainly, on the broader context, he has also reiterated and also identified the greatest challenges faced by the Palestinian people, mostly on the issue of persistent illegal policies and practices of the Israeli government in the occupied Palestinian territories. The way forward, he has also put it very clearly among us. And finally, the reiteration of Indonesia's strong position to support the realization of the inalienable rights of the Palestinian people. Thank you again, Ambassador. I have now the honor to give the floor to Ambassador Riyad Mansour, permanent observer of the State of Palestine to the United Nations in New York.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chair, Ambassador Perkaya, and also allow me to thank, you know, my good friend Hassan Klaib for his statement on behalf of the Foreign Ministry of Indonesia, and for all of the solidarity and support contained in that statement to the Palestinian people, to the struggle of the Palestinian people, and also to the question of Jerusalem. Allow me also, Mr. Vice Chair, through you to thank, you know, the Committee on the Exercise of the Inalienable Rights of the Palestinian People for organizing this conference. This is the second international conference in Jerusalem. We will continue with this tradition of having an annual international conference in Jerusalem through partnership between the Committee on the Exercise of the Inalienable Rights of the Palestinian People, the OIC, and the League of Arab States. And in this connection, I add my voice to yours in welcoming the two foreign ministers who have addressed this conference yesterday, the Foreign Minister of Indonesia and the Foreign Minister of the State of Palestine, as well as the participation of the Secretary General of the OIC and the Assistant Secretary General of the League of Arab States among us. Allow me also to express our gratitude to the team from the Foreign Ministry of Indonesia for facilitating the work, for their outstanding work, for the team of the Division of Palestinian Rights, are the soldiers who make everything, you know, a success as we see it. They are the soldiers behind the scene that they take care of organizing everything to make this conference a successful one. To the participants, to the representatives of government, civil societies, to the journalists, to everyone who have participated in contributing to the success of this conference. We are very grateful for your contribution. And it goes without saying that this second international conference in Jerusalem was convened in Indonesia, the third largest democracy and the largest country with a population of people of the Islamic faith. On these days where we see this uprising of our youth and our people that started in Jerusalem to defend Al-Aqsa Mosque and Al-Haram Sharif and the entire occupied Palestinian territory, including Jerusalem. So it happened by accident that we selected Jakarta to be the place for convening the second international conference in these historical moments in which we are going through the time of the third month of the popular uprising of the Palestinian people against occupation and against the attempts of the Israeli occupation of dividing Al-Aqsa Mosque and Al-Haram al-Sharif in terms of time and in terms of place, which outraged the Palestinian people completely, outraged all the Arab nation, and outraged the Islamic Ummah from all corners of the globe. So we meet at this historical moment, and I am sure that the statement of Foreign Minister Riyad Malki covered many aspects of that issue, which I need not to to repeat. We hope that we will convene the third international conference in Jerusalem, maybe in Africa, so that we will be moving in all continents to mobilize the largest possible support to the heart of the Palestine question. When we talk about Jerusalem, it's not as if there is a solution for Jerusalem without ending the occupation of all the occupied land that Israel occupied since the 4th of June of 1967. So when we talk about Jerusalem, we talk about the heart of the state of Palestine. There cannot be an independence of our state without ending the occupation of East Jerusalem and without the complete liberation of Al-Aqsa Mosque and Al-Haram al-Sharif, because Al-Aqsa Mosque and Al-Haram al-Sharif, for us, the Palestinian people, whether we are religious or not, whether we are Muslims or Christian, but it resembles the identity, the essence of what it means to be a Palestinian, the essence of the Palestine question, the essence of the state of Palestine. So therefore, the issue of Al-Haram al-Sharif and Al-Aqsa Mosque, it is not only a location of a holy place, it is much, much more than that. It is what it means to be Palestine. It is what it means to be the national cause of the Palestinian people. So when we convene under the banner of Jerusalem, we are summing the whole issue of the question of Palestine and ending the occupation and the independence of the state of Palestine so that we can save the two-state solution. Now, in this connection, many speakers dealt with so many different issues related to the question of Jerusalem. You cannot discuss Jerusalem as if it is completely divorced from the reality of occupation. You have to discuss it within that context. And in this regard, of course, we are the Palestinian people do not deny spiritual connection with Jerusalem by all those who follow the three religions and even more. If you are in Indonesia and you are a Muslim, you have the full right to have a spiritual connection with Jerusalem. if you are Christian in Peru and you want to have spiritual connection with Jerusalem, by all means, you have the right to do so. If you are a Jew in any place, you have the right to have a spiritual connection with Jerusalem, but nobody has the right to have a real state connection with Jerusalem except the people who live in Jerusalem, who own Jerusalem, and that is the way it is. You cannot say if you are a Christian and you have spiritual connection with the Vatican that you want to translate that into a real state connection and control over the Vatican. That's not possible. It doesn't make sense. So by the same rule, we say as Palestinians, anyone can have a spiritual connection with Jerusalem, but don't translate it into a real state connection to control the city. That is the full domain of the Palestinian people because it is the capital of our state and it is the heart of Palestine. Now, of course, the reality that we see is advancing the question of providing international protection to the Palestinian people. And in this regard, we all know that the Fourth Geneva Convention is the instrument that regulates the relationship between the people who live under occupation and the occupiers. And according to the provisions of the Fourth Geneva Convention, it states that the occupier is responsible for providing protection for the civilian population until the end of occupation because occupation is of a temporary nature. But when the occupying power forfeits its responsibility and abandoned its responsibility to provide protection for the civilian population, and I add more than that, and if the occupying power is the source of harming the civilian population under its occupation, then it becomes the responsibility of the international community, including the Security Council, to be involved in providing protection for the civilian population. This is similar to this concept that is becoming popular at the United Nations of the responsibility to protect. When a government forfeits its responsibility to protect its people, and in fact, if a government starts harming its own people, then the international community is saying that we have the responsibility to protect the civilian population in such government. This is more or less similar to the situation of the Israeli occupation to the Palestinian people, and therefore we expect that this issue of international protection to be discussed more seriously by the Security Council, not with the view of just legislating another resolution to reaffirm our right to be protected until the end of occupation, because the Security Council adopted at least two resolutions in the past, 1605, which was adopted in December 1987, and a resolution was adopted in 1994 after the massacre in Al-Khalil Mosque. So in these two resolutions, the Security Council accepted the principle to provide international protection to the Palestinian civilian population, including in resolution 904 of having on temporary basis international presence, including observers, and it also stipulated that the settlers should be disarmed as well. So therefore, the Security Council accepted the principle of providing the Palestinian people with protection, and they did that not under Chapter 7, but in a regular resolution. Nevertheless, they accepted the principle. And we succeeded in our efforts with the Secretary General and the legal department of the Security of the Secretariat to prepare a study about examples and modalities of providing protections to the civilian population under similar circumstances. And this study is in the hands of the Security Council, and it is our collective responsibility to do the follow-up on that dimension of providing protection, which is the Security Council. With regard to the Secretary General, and I know that there is a representative of the Secretary General in this conference, Previous Secretary Generals, you know, did submit reports and modalities of providing protection for the Palestinian people, and we are engaging in discussion with the current Secretary General so that we can be creative in dealing with this issue, especially since there is a large presence of different UN manifestations on the ground in the occupied territory, to come up with ideas of also contributing to this process of providing protection for the Palestinian people until the end of occupation. And also the General Assembly is responsible to do so. In fact, the first peacekeeping force that was established in 1948-49 and in the after the attacks to Sinai and the Suez Canal were established by the General Assembly, not by the Security Council. So therefore, the General Assembly has a responsibility to shoulder in connection with providing protection. And in fact, we just finished voting on resolutions related to the question of Palestine, 18 of them this year. And in more than one of these resolutions, there is a clear call for providing protection for the Palestinian people under occupation. And in 13 of these resolutions, the European Union unanimously voted in favor, including on the issue of providing protection to the Palestinian people. So that this, the issue of protection is not an invention from our imagination. It is a derivative of the lack of security to the Palestinian civilian population as a result of the attacks from the Israeli occupying forces and from the armed settlers and other militias against our people. Therefore, the international community has to deal with this issue of protection and to provide our people with protection. Let me just add three things actually, and to conclude with. One, as we convene these, you know, conferences on Jerusalem on an annual basis, we also this year succeeded in organizing a conference on settlements, the other major obstacles to opening doors for meaningful political process that would lead to the end of occupation within a reasonable time, and therefore the independence of the state of Palestine and the saving the two-state solution. We had a conference in Brussels with our partners, the League of Arab States and the OIC, on settlements, as we are having this conference on Jerusalem with our partners as well. So therefore, there has been tradition in concentrating and mobilizing on key issues that constitute obstacles to any meaningful political process. The other thing is that we don't talk to you only about politics and diplomacy and mobilization. In this conference, we are delighted that we were able, you know, through collaboration with many parties and also facilitation from the Foreign Ministry of Indonesia and active role by our ambassador here in Indonesia, that we brought one of our famous cultural groups from Palestine, so that to show you another dimension of the reality of the Palestinian people, while we live under occupation, while we suffer tremendously, while we'll bury our mortars almost on daily basis, while we attend to the wounds of our injured Palestinians, and while we also suffer from the stories and horrors of our heroes and prisoners in Israeli prisons, yet we know that life has a positive aspect to it. It is our culture, it is our stories, it is, you know, that the relationship between Palestinian youth, men and women, they dance, they sing for hope, they sing for the future, they sing for peace, they sing for the land, the love for the land, the vegetation of our land, the harvest seasons, all of the normal stories of people when they display these things through their culture. So we are sharing this with you, and I believe that this evening you will be exposed to this sample of the story of the Palestinian people. It is not only politics, it is not only suffering, it is not only refugees, it is not only settlements, it is not only denial of our rights in Jerusalem and building separation walls and settlements and displacement and demolition of homes, but also in addition to all these things, it is our stories, the youth, how they're living, including our youth in the Gaza Strip, which has been besieged illegally and immorally for a long period of time. So that's another component that we will be sharing with you in this conference. Let me conclude by saying that we are not convening these conferences to reiterate principal positions. We have tons of these reiterations, including legislating them in resolutions, whether at the United Nations, whether in conferences of the OIC, or conferences of the non-aligned movement, or the League of Arab States, or in many other organizations. We need to move into the direction of more of a practical steps. We are doing some of it at the United Nations, including in the Security Council. But we need from, for example, the Organization of Islamic Conference, which was established to defend Jerusalem as a result of what happened in Jerusalem in 1967, 1968, when there were attempts to burn Al-Haram al-Sharif. We believe that as Palestine is seeking legal options through the ICC of trying to go after those criminals who have committed all these crimes against our people, that they should not continue to enjoy impunity and to run away from facing justice. We believe that, you know, as we are pursuing the ICC in order to go after those criminals, it is high time, for example, for the OIC to start considering legal options of how they can hold Israel responsible, including in courts, including in the ICJ, if they see that that is possible, to challenge the unilateral illegal action of Israel of annexing East Jerusalem and trying to impose its will against the international community. I think it is our collective responsibility to start thinking of legal options of how we can go after those who are trampling, you know, international law, after those who are disrespecting international law, because Israel was created as a result of the United Nations making a resolution to divide Palestine, and they enjoyed that benefit from international law, so that they cannot only enjoy one part of international law and deny the all other parts of international law. So I think that we have to do something in order to pursue, even in national courts, as the case, for example, with South Africa, in which they are issuing warrants of arrest of certain military leaders of Israel to hold them responsible for crimes committed against humanity and against the Palestinian people. The 57 member states of the OIC, some of them have relationship with Israel. We need to begin the discussion of how we can hold Israel accountable, including in domestic national laws of these countries, to go after those who are committing all these crimes, and up to go after those who are challenging and denying Security Council resolution when the Security Council states that the unilateral action of Israel of annexing Jerusalem is null and void and it has no legal obligation. We need to move from stating this fact into pursuing it in courts in order to go after those who made these illegal decisions and to make them accountable for these their illegal actions. I'm just giving examples. We should not trust, and we should not allow the Palestinian people only to carry the torch of freedom and dignity and putting an end to occupation and defending Jerusalem, while all of our other brothers and sisters in the Islamic Ummah, which we appreciate their support, We appreciate their position, but I think that we need, after 50 years of occupation, to shift gears and to resort to practical measures in order really to force the Israeli occupying authority to yield to the collective will of the international community, to yield to international law and to their obligation under international law, because that would be your contribution to your brothers and sisters who are in the forefront, the Palestinians, who are resisting occupation, fighting for the liberation of the land of their state with East Jerusalem as its capital. I believe that you will join with us in finding creative ways in order to contribute to the struggle that will one day, and hopefully soon, will lead to the end of occupation, to the independence of our state, and the attainment of our freedom and dignity as Palestinians, and to really defend Jerusalem and to keep it in the hearts and minds of all of those who love Jerusalem, regardless of which religion they belong to. It is our destiny as Palestinians to be on the forefront to accomplish that. Thank you very much, and thank you for being with us in this conference. Please take something positive with you and do whatever you can in your capacity, whether you are a representative of government, whether you are an NGO representative, or media, or whatever. Just do what needs to be done in supporting justice for the Palestinian people. Thank you very much, Mr. Co-Chair.
I thank Ambassador Riyad Mansour for his very comprehensive concluding statement. Excellencies, distinguished speakers, ladies and gentlemen, the presentations and discussions of the last 2 days indeed provided us with a deep insight into the current situation in Jerusalem, and also a very useful expertise on ways to solve this seemingly intractable question. We heard about the deterioration of the situation in the recent months, how Palestinians are dispossessed from their own homes and quarters, how they are made a minority in their own city, how the Israeli authorities are neglecting Arab neighborhoods, schools, and streets. We also heard that the state of Palestine is prevented from any political activity in Jerusalem, contrary to the agreements of the 1990s, and about a systematic policy to try to prevent, through the changing the demographic in the city, the Palestinians to ever be able to establish East Jerusalem as the capital of their state. But we also learn that this division between the Jewish and Arab inhabitants of Jerusalem is relatively recent development, and that until not so long ago, people of all faiths lived peacefully in the city, and not merely next to each other, but with each other. Our experts also provided models of how such a true coexistence can be achieved in the future. Excellencies, distinguished speakers, ladies and gentlemen, as we were repeatedly reminded during the presentations by our distinguished experts and the discussions, within the larger question of Palestine, Jerusalem is one of the most difficult of the so-called final status issues. It involves political, demographic, economic, and religious concerns. It is this last aspect, the religious importance of Jerusalem for three major world religions, that most resonates with the people around the world when they think about Palestine. But let us be clear, this conflict is not about religion. It is about the dispossession of a people from their rights and their land. We should be aware of this fact and reject attempts to persuade us to interpret this conflict through a religious framework. This would only serve the interests of those who wish to portray the Palestinian cause as an extremist cause, an intractable conflict, so they can justify a strong security and militaristic approach appealing to the fears of international public opinion and thus continue with the occupation. Turning to the struggle for Palestinian rights into a religious conflict would definitely contribute to the efforts of those fanatics who wish to corrupt and misguide the Muslim youth in Europe, in Asia, in America, and here in our region in Asia. Such a situation would most likely push further away any possibility of achieving Palestinian rights. It is imperative that the nations of the world, united in our esteemed organization, which this year celebrated its 70th anniversary, continue all efforts to avoid such a scenario in the General Assembly and the Security Council at our headquarters in New York, with our friends and partners like the Organization of the Islamic Cooperation, and in our capitals and member states. The international community must take concerted action to persuade Israel to cease its provocations and violations, especially on the Al-Aqsa Mosque compound. At the same time, we must do all we can to provide the Palestinian people with a positive perspective that they will not be abandoned by the nations of the world because of other conflicts and concern. The message needs to be very clear. We will not cease our efforts until the Israeli occupation has ended, until the Palestinian people has achieved all their inalienable rights in the free and sovereign state of Palestine. Excellencies, distinguished speakers, ladies and gentlemen, please note that the chair summary of this international conference and the papers presented by the expert will be available on the UN Question of Palestine website shortly. The press releases covering this meeting will also be available on the website. Our rapporteur, Ambassador Christopher Grima of Malta, will report on the findings to the whole committee when we return to New York. A comprehensive report of this meeting will definitely be published by the Secretariat in due course. In conclusion, I would like to express our committee's sincere appreciation to the staff of the Division for Palestinian Rights of the United Nations Secretariat, to the conference services team of the UN office in Vienna, especially Cornelia Fischer, thank you very much. The press officers, the interpreters, Mr. Nabil Abdel Al, Ms. Maya Reyes, Ms. Maria Riachi. I think you have endured the torture of 2 days within the cubicle and struggling to follow the speed of the speakers. Thank you very much. The staff and management of the Borobudur Hotel in Jakarta, and all others who worked for so long hours to make this meeting a successful one. And last but not least, again, as Deputy Minister Hassan Kleb has said earlier, I would also like to thank the presence and coverage from our colleague in the media. Thank you very much. Now I declare close the international conference on the question of Palestine. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you.
Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to have your attention to make a short practical announcement. This evening, there will be a Palestinian cultural night at Balai Sarbini in Semanggi. Transportation will be provided. Please gather at 5 p.m. at the back lobby of this hotel near the Grand Manhattan Club. In addition, there will be a movie screening of a Palestinian movie called The Wanted 18 at 16:45 p.m. also at Balai Sarbini, and the entrance is free. You are welcome to join us. Thank you very much.